The following is an interview with Regina Silver at 30935 Perry's Crossing, Farmington Hills, Michigan, June 21, 1982. The interviewer is Charlene Green. You understand this interview will be used for educational purposes and public use. Confidentiality on any part is permissible. I will be asking you questions on your pre-war background, your life during the war, and your liberation, and your attitudes. Do you understand this?
Yes.
Okay. Will you please state your name and where you were born?
I'm born in Poland. The little town is called Sarnaki.
Give me your name.
Regina Silverstein.
Could you spell it for me?
Z-I-L-B-E-R-S-Z-T-E-N-T-E-J-N.
Try that again. And go slower.
Z-Y-L-B-E-R-S-Z-T-E-J-N.
Very good. Okay. And now what is your name?
Now is my name Silver. Regina Silver, S-I-L-V-E-R.
Okay. Now, can you tell me where you were born?
Born in Poland.
In a town?
Sarnaki.
Okay. Can you describe your life before the war?
Before the war? What is it like before the war? Was a life a normal life? Like every Jewish family was living in a house and... I have my first born in 1937, yeah. I got married in 1936. And my husband was in the army when the war broke out in 1939. And I was left with a child, he was 2 years old. And then he came back. After already the Germans arrived in our town, and we ran away together. In 1940, I lost my first baby.
Wait, you're going way too fast. What was your husband's occupation?
Before the war?
Yes.
He was with my father. My father got a mill.
A what?
A mill, you know, a mill, but it makes flour.
Oh, a mill? Well. Can you give me the size of your family, immediate and extended?
My family, we was 7 brothers, my father, my stepmother, and my mother. When the war broke out, I was with them, with my little boy. So we were together 7 and 9, and 11.
And how about other family, the extended family rather than the immediate? Cousins, aunts, uncles?
Oh, they were all in there, yes. I got aunties and uncles and cousins, but plenty. I got 3 uncles, and I got 1 auntie, and I got many cousins before the war, which I haven't got nobody was left.
How many were lost? Do you know?
My family from the cousins, like my father ran away to Russia with my brothers, they survived. They are born in Cyrus. One brother died in Houston. But my father ran away with all the kids to Russia, together with us. And the rest of the family, my father's 2, a brother and a sister and many children, they all perished. Mm-hmm. My immediate family survived.
Can you describe what your family life was like?
Oh, my family life was normal, not so extravagant. I had a stepmother all my life. She wasn't so hot to me anyways. But then I got married very young. And we lived a normal life. My husband didn't make too much money because he was right... 2 years before I got married, a year I got a child, and then they took him away to the army when the war broke out. He was 7 months in the army.
This is the Polish army?
Polish army, yeah.
Can you describe your community? How many synagogues there were?
In my little town where I lived was maybe four small synagogues, not too big ones. It was a small town.
How about schools?
Yeah, it was one school.
Was it a Jewish school?
No, it wasn't a Jewish school. It was a cheder. It wasn't a Jewish school. It was a cheder, like a rabbi, and they used to teach. But it was a public school, the Polish public school.
Oh.
I attend Polish public school. In the Jewish education, I was going to a rabbi, like a rabbi, learned, you know, after school.
What degree of assimilation was there in your community?
What do you mean, similar, like a Jewish with goyim?
Yes.
Very small.
Very small?
Very small. I don't remember.
What was your family's religious practices?
Well, my father was religious. My stepmother's still in Buenos Aires alive. She's Meshigafrim. Very religious.
How did you keep your Sabbath?
Me?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, now in Canada?
Before the war with your husband.
With my husband? I kept nicht so free, but I was benching licht all the time.
I
light the candles, but I didn't go to mikveh.
And how did your father's family do it?
My father, they were religious, yeah, very religious.
Can you describe a Friday night? What a Friday night was like?
Oh, Friday night? My father went to shul, and my stepmother prepared gefilte fish, and we baked challahs and cakes. And especially when my father was a milner, you know, my flour wasn't, was plenty. So I used to wake up early in the morning, 6 o'clock, and used to make challahs and make cakes. And we sing as mirrors, like by the table with my brothers. My father used to keep a rabbi special to learn the children, and I used to listen. I'm of us oldest in my house. Yeah. Before the war, I mean.
Did you attend services also?
No. Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. Oh, I didn't have many Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, like I was a girl but when I got married. So then, not long, the war broke out. So Russia didn't go to shul.
What were your family's political affiliations?
Oh, they were Zionistish always.
Did they ever speak of what was happening in the 30s?
My father?
Mm-hmm.
Not as I remember. My father was a businessman. Oh, yeah, I don't think so. I ever speak politics with the children. I never knew.
Can you describe your education?
My education, I got to public school before the war. I didn't go to high school.
But was that eighth grade?
Yes. I still read and write Polish.
Did you encounter anti-Semitism before the war?
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead. Well, can you describe it? Though?
Yeah, I remember once in my little town, you know, when the war broke out, they had to make us run away from Poland to the Russian side because the Polacks were banging all night. They throw stones in our house and they wanted to kill my father. There was the week when the war broke out with Poland and the Germans. The Poles just exist a week. And then the police and everybody ran away. It was like without law. They just knew my father wasn't a poor man, and they all night they come in and they want to grab my father and kill him. That what made us run away from right over the book, over the water, to go to the Russian side, not to stay with the Germans.
Over the river?
It was a lot, we were 5 kilometers from the border we were living.
Mm.
Like it's called Book. That was a river, a teich, you know, a river, a vadel, but divided. But it's like a big river.
Oh,
but okay. Divided, you know, it's called the Book. Was in this side the river was like the Lutva, Litva, she mentioned, and the Lutvakas. Mm-hmm. This side river was Poland, but the Polish, the Poles took it to this side, and the Russian was over the river. So we ran away in the Russian side.
Do you remember how you heard about the war?
When the war broke out?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it was right away on the radio. The radio. That was in 1939.
Do you remember?
They started a bombardier, the bombers was falling over the heads. And I remember it was before Rosh Hashanah, the war broke out, and my stepmother was sending me, I was walking by a field, 10 kilometers in a small town to look for a shochet, to shechten the chickens, the kapurus, in the bombers, the airplanes were going over my head, I was hiding in the bushes. I could have got killed before the chickens. Yeah, it's true. I came to my auntie, to my father's sister, you know, in the house. They were all on the fields. Nobody was home. And when my auntie saw me coming in with these chickens, she just said, God, why are you so stupid to go? So my mimet magishik. So it should be your daughter. She wouldn't send you. Like, she didn't care if I got killed, you know. She was so upset why I was risking my life to go to the Shechten Kapurs, because they wouldn't, it was Erev Rosh Hashanah, mm-hmm. and they wouldn't eat the chickens if somebody would kill it. They have to be a shochet. And then I came to this little town, was the first bomb fell there. And, you know, I knew my girlfriend got killed then in front of a bomb. When I knew a man, but his children ran away from their own house because they hide in a basement in somebody else's house. So all the three kids got killed. This man is now still living in, he lives in Israel, I think. It was his wife and the three children got verschotten. They thought their house will be bombarded. But what just happened, the neighbor's house got fell in a bomb and they got killed. When I know his sister, he still lives in Israel. She was my girlfriend. Got killed too, Shapiro, you know. You don't know.
Do you remember your thoughts?
When?
When this was all going on.
Well, my thoughts was to survive and see my husband back alive. Because he was in the army.
Oh, he was in the army.
And I was left with a child who was 2 years old. And then I lost this child. My husband came back and find me already not in my house. He find me in the Shemiatich, like I said, over the river where we ran away with my father, let him rest in peace, and with all my seven brothers.
You ran away immediately?
We ran away from Poland when the Germans took over, sure. We ran away right away. And then the Russians want us to move farther from there, but because this was the border. We were there in the border town. They want us to move farther, and they want us to take Russian passports. So we are Polish citizens. We thought the war will end a week or two, and we will return to our homes. So we didn't want to take Russian passports, and this was the miracle when we lived through the war. If we would take Russian passports, we would fall into to the Nazis and we got killed the same as the 6 million. That the surviving for the Russian Jews was like a miracle happened. My husband's brother, the oldest brother, was with us, and he ran back. And he went away to Treblinka. Oh, he got lost. I don't know where he was killed.
Can you describe what the Russians did to you? What they, why, what?
The Russians they took us to Russia, sent us away, and on Friday night, they organized all people who didn't accept the Russian passports to send them away to prisoners of camp prisoners, like we were against Russia.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? Because we didn't want to accept citizens, Russian citizens, because we said we Polish citizens. If we would accept Russian citizens, they would send our men away on the front fighting. And we didn't want to be a Russian citizen. We were Polish citizens, want to stay Polish citizens. So they sent us away like we were against Russia. Send us away. And that was the miracle we survived.
Can you describe the camp you were sent to?
I was sent to lager where they was iron the mines. My husband was working by in the iron mines. We were living in a barrack on the canters every night. We weren't allowed to go anywhere else, just to be in this area where we were sent. We lived maybe till Russia started to fight with the Germans, till the war broke out. Germans and the Russians started the war. Then we Polish citizen got free. Was a Polish general. His name was General Sikorski. But he got killed in an airplane crash. I don't know if you know the history. They think that the English, the England killed them.
Would you describe what the barracks looked like?
In
Russia.
It was a small little room. We got one little bed. When they sent us, they didn't give us any mattresses or anything. I didn't have anything because they cut me in Brest-Litovsk and mine stuff was by uncle of mine in Prozhany. And everything in my house, they want us to go farther from the sites where it was close to Russia, they want us to go farther. So my husband went away to Beskotos to look for a place to live. And I went to see my father was in another little town with the family. So they cut me on the road already without a passport. I didn't have a Russian passport. So I came to my uncle back and they told me my husband is gone already. He didn't come back. So I knew they put him in, they cut him on the streets in Brest-Litovsk and they put him in jail for not having a Russian passport. So when I came back to see my uncle, so I came back and said my husband is gone already a week. So right away I turned back, took a bus. When I went with the train already, they harassed me. They didn't leave me alone. They wanted to put me already in jail because I was not a Russian citizen. So then I helped my husband. Came a week already back to my uncle in Prozhany. So I said, I bet you they put him in jail. So I ran back with our bus to Brest-Litovsk, and I came there Friday night. This was the Friday night where the Russian organized to send away all Polish citizens deep in Russia as prisoners of war. And they cut me in a place, but I went to sleep there, but I knew my husband's brother was there. And I came to this place, my husband's brother was already in jail too. So then they kept me 3 nights and 3 days. They wanted to put me right in the wagons and send me away deep in Russia when I didn't have my husband. When I was pregnant already then with a baby, right? Because I lost my first child then. So I was pregnant. I was crying so hard, and I told them, let me come together with my husband, because I left all my things in Prozhany by my uncle. And then you could send me wherever you wanted. They didn't listen to me. They just grabbed me and wanted to put me in the train. It was wagons staying at the station already, packed with people like animals packed. And I was crying so hard. I didn't have any money. I have just a pair of sandals in a little summer dress and nothing. I left everything behind and by my uncle. I thought I was going to come back. So I started to cry so hard and I told them, let me go. They told me that the people, they grabbed the man on the streets in Brest-Litovsk. So they sitting by the jail and waiting for the Nachalnik, the big macho Nachalnik, to come out. And every woman, but they knew your husband sitting in jail, they was crying and begging. Some of them managed to take them out, but I didn't manage even to come in the morning to go to the jail, because they, in the same night, they came into the to this place where I was. I begged this man to let me sleep over. It was in Breslitosa. They locked me in a room. It was another woman, and it was the night that the Russian organized, and they cut me in this room. They came in with guns, and I was so scared. I ran behind the bed. And I was laying behind the bed, and I thought, the last minute they leave, maybe I got the opportunity in the morning to go to the jail, and maybe I could take out my husband. So the last minute, this Krasna Army, the Red Army, they like say, they were like a soldier from the Red Army, took a flashlight and he looked behind the bed. He started screaming. I was run from behind the bed. I was shaking like a leaf. You know, I started to talk about Polish and about Russian. I couldn't speak Russian then. Well, I said, I just came from Prozhany. My husband, did they cut him in the street in Brasvetos? Let him go. Then we'll send me. You'll do with me what you want. Just let me be together with my husband. I have nothing. I have no money. I have nothing. So they said to me, good, 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 we'll do it. They put me in a bus, and right to the station. And I come to the station, I know I was pregnant, and I have no money, nothing. I was crying so hard. So I was screaming to this soldier, shoot me. Because if you don't let me go, take out my husband, so what am I going to do by myself with no money, with nothing? So I was screaming so hard. Finally, there was a lot of women already in the wagon, in the wagons, crying and begging they should let them come together with the husbands. They were already on the street. They were grabbing and putting them in the jail because they didn't accept the Russian passports. This was the miracle. We survived.
The Polish passports.
We have to have a Russian passport. Oh. We were Polish citizens. We didn't want to accept the Russian passport.
Oh, okay.
So they don't let us stay. Mm-hmm. They put us away as prisoners of war and away from everything. They didn't let us free.
So they used a bus to transport you to this camp?
So they want to put me in the train. I start very much to cry. Then a higher authority. Mm-hmm. Walked by, and they saw they already two men, soldiers, fighting with me, and they want to push me in the wagons, and I didn't want to go. So he asked, what's the problem? So I started to talk about Russian, about Polish, and I was so upset and crying. And he said, what's the matter? So I told him, they grabbed my husband on the street, and my husband is in jail. I just want them to let out my husband and let them send me whatever they want together, what I'm going to do by myself, because I already lost my first child. And then I was pregnant with the second. So finally, they took us, they opened up the wagons, and they asked which woman had the man in jail. So they let out a lot of women. They took a truck, and they put us in a, it's like in a place, in a big building, was like closed up, like in a yard. They let us out, and they start to write names for everybody, names, names, names. We were 3 nights and 3 days laying on the stones outside. No food, no nothing. They bring out a little water. A woman had a baby in front of us on the street there they ask names, names, names every morning. It just was started. The day came, a little truck came in, and people ran to this. And they let out men, and they let the family recognize them. So the third day in the morning was already started, the daytime started to come. They came a little truck, and I ran over my husband. He came out, and he didn't know what happened, because he knew I went away to see my father. And then he saw me, and he saw his younger brother also, they cut him on the street. So he was so pale, he was so white. His hands were so wrinkled, like from sweat. They put it in one cabin. Maybe 50 people, but the cabin was just for 5 people. There was not a place even to sit, not to just to lay. In the night they have to lay like sardines. If one turned over, all of them have to turn over. And they were The sweat was running from them. They got, to go in the washroom. They got a pail in the same room. And if they open up a little window to let them a little bit fresh air, they just, if somebody was talking on board, they right away closed the little window. And he said, my husband Sammy, he said, if I wouldn't take him out, he said, he would die. In somebody, all 5 minutes, somebody else fainted. And they drag it out in the hall and pull a pail of cold water on him. If it survived, it survived. Nothing, he died like a dog. Nobody even see it, nobody even knew it. Then finally we got together with my husband. When they took us in the wagons, without nothing, we were 3 weeks in the wagons. When they on the
way, wagon?
In the train wagons, big okay. wagons. When they took us there and they sent us, we went for 3 weeks in the train. On the way, I didn't have nothing to change. She was a Polish woman, a Polish girl. She went with a Jewish, like a lover. So I begged her on the same wagon to borrow me a little dress to wash, to change my clothes because I didn't have nothing. When they sent us away for all, the place was called Diktarka.
It was called what?
Diktarka. It was a place where they mines, like I said before. When we lived there, maybe till the war broke out. And then we went away to Turkestan. When in Turkestan, I had my baby.
Wait a minute, then you were there less than 7 months?
No, on Diktarka I have my baby. And when I went to Turkestan, I lost the baby back. It was 10 months. I was about a year, maybe a year and a half on this place.
What did you do in this camp, the first camp? What is the name of it again?
Diktarka.
Diktarka?
Diktarka, it's a Russian place. When there was my iron mines.
Oh, your husband went to work in the iron
mines? Iron mines, yeah. And I got the baby, I was with the baby.
And the women were allowed to just take care of their babies in the home?
Yes,
or what,
the women were allowed. Yeah, if they have small children, they can't go to work. They are allowed to stay with the children. If they didn't have children, they went to work too.
And what were your living accommodations there?
In the barrack.
It was
a little room, that's all, with one bed, with one closet.
Oh, it was like individual rooms?
Yeah, just one room.
Can you give me an idea of the size of the room?
The size of the room? Let's put it the way it is, like this.
It's about the size of this room
we're in? Yeah, it was narrower and longer. Narrower than this. Longer.
All right, let's say that this room is 10 by 15. Would you say that this room's a 10 by 15?
No, not even this. It was smaller.
Smaller. Was about an 8 by 10?
That's more like it.
Or maybe an 8 by 12, longer and thinner?
Longer and thinner.
Maybe an 8 by 12. And they had in it a bed? What is it, a twin bed or a larger than a twin bed?
No, it was like a double bed. Together in the bed,
mm-hmm.
me and my husband. I don't think it was double. Maybe it was a twin bed we were sleeping together.
Maybe it was a three-quarter or something.
Maybe a three-quarter.
What else was in the room?
Little table. And we got a little stove to burn like wood.
Uh-huh.
It was a wooden stove to burn for warmth.
And what about food? How did you get food?
Well, we got supermarkets. We went back.
It was like a town then?
A little town, yeah, sure.
You mean your husband would earn money and then he would go?
He would work, yeah. He was working in the mines and they give him a payroll and or food stamps or whatever. They come to the supermarket and we could go and buy for money.
And then you bought clothes that way also?
Clothes, not very little clothes. My uncle then from Prusanda, but I left everything there. They sent me a few parcels, came with my things, but I left it there.
Oh, and the Russians allowed it in?
Then the Russians allowed it in. Then they mailed it, they came, my things, but I left it there. They let it out when they came. I sold it, I got a little bit. They sold it, I got a ring and a gold ring. I sold it between people there. What you ever can make, so you could sell even a shirt, anything would you got for yourself to make money.
What would you do with the money after you got it?
Well, buy what we can get, buy food, buy milk.
You couldn't get enough?
I used to cook a cabbage, a big cabbage with one glass of milk. I used to put in potatoes and cabbage and a half a glass of milk. But I have a glass I need it for my baby. Put it more water than milk. And then we struggle.
There was a lack of food? Was there wasn't enough, you weren't making enough money to be able to buy all the food you needed?
No, we weren't hungry. I mean, we wouldn't have luxury, but we got food. We live as much as we can, we live.
Do you remember anything, were there any exterminations in the camp?
Exterminations, no.
Executions, I think, is the word I'm looking for. I'm sorry.
Executions, no.
Was there any kind of special law that you had to follow?
Oh, yeah, sure. We couldn't go nowhere by ourselves. And we like, normally we don't, we in our house, like in our room, we could do whatever we want, sing and eat and do what we want. They didn't, but they count us every night. Came in a man and count how many people was in the room. Like they know, they got every barrack has a number. How many people live in this room? How many people in this room? But they didn't execute us. No.
Did they? Do you remember any celebrations, holiday celebrations there?
For me?
Yeah, in this camp. In the barracks?
No, we didn't have any celebrations.
You don't remember like anything for Hanukkah, a special celebration or anything?
No.
Nobody thought of holidays?
No. If there was Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, there was some people where they started davening in one place, in a room.
Mm-hmm.
Put on the wolf once to be religious, put on a talus and daven, but not any special places to go. No.
Did you meet other people there? Did you socialize at all?
Oh, a lot.
You met in each other's rooms?
We met a lot of people that are living right next door to me in the same barrack. We knew each other. We used to meet outside. We used to meet and go to each other's places.
What did you do when you were together?
We were talking stories, singing, laughing, crying. What are you doing in places like that?
Was there any smuggling in there in order to bring in extra food?
Smuggling? Some people buy even from the supermarkets, but they get it out and they're selling quietly in behind, you know, if you want extra, you have to. It was a black market.
Did anything ever form like a resistance group in order to try and break out?
No.
Were you aware of what was going on in Poland?
They came through ideas that they're killing the Jewish people. Once somebody got a letter from Israel and they say that the Jews should say Kaddish for the Polish Jewry because they're killing everybody. And some people say, what do you mean they're killing everybody? This is Russian propaganda. They didn't want to believe it.
Did you believe it?
Not quite, no. Nobody would believe it that they were going to make everybody and put them in the gas chambers or killing them, everybody. We thought the killing was our war. People were falling from bombs, murders like the Germans did kill. Nobody would believe it. No, nobody.
Does any particular experience stand out in your mind, in your memory?
What the main experience?
Something that happened in one camp, let's start with this camp. Anything particular that happened in this one camp that you remember? Out of the usual?
What I can remember when the war ended, they let us go free, we went away from there. We went to Tashkent.
This is at the end you're talking.
Yeah, no, it was not the end. And we came to the Tashkent, they didn't let us stay. Then we went to Turkestan. When I got a small baby, what I had in this place, Diktarka, when my baby was 10 months, and I got sick on the train. When I came to this Turkestan, I didn't know where to go. I didn't know where I was even a Jewish. I didn't know it was even a hospital. A Tatar took us in when I went to the hospital, they took my baby in the hospital, and it was just 24 hours. He didn't survive because they put him in a bath of cold water. He got the measles then. I didn't know it was measles. And the measles came out, came out from inside. And caught pneumonia, and right away it was gone. So when the baby died, this is what I can remember all my life. I was sitting, they took the body from my baby, and I was sitting outside the whole night, me and my husband. We didn't know what to do. Because all night they took out the corpse of my child with a little bed. But standing outside was amazing. It wasn't so cold. So in the morning I find I was back. And we didn't know that it was existing, even a Jewish cemetery there. So there was back. We wrapped the child in a little blanket they gave me from the hospital. And me and my husband were carrying the dead baby to bury with those back, with that one. And they made a hole in the clay. It was Nazi, it was clay a lot. So they made a hole. And there I laid my baby in this hole on those back, covered with the ground. We were stood, me and my husband, couldn't even cry. We were standing we were stunned, you know, but I don't know what the special passion, like stones. And the Uzbek was saying a prayer for my child. And weeks and months went by, I didn't even remember that to go see it, because I found out after the Jewish cemetery. I couldn't even find the grave. It was like in heels, in clay. We lay down, my baby was 10 months old, beautiful boy. And this thing is what I remember very vividly. It was never go away from my memory. Till I closed my eyes. And my first child I lost in 94. It was 3 years and 4 months old. He died from a sickness, meningitis. It wasn't medicine. It was yet before they sent us a veterinary. Right after, when I went to my uncle, like I say, in Prozhany. There I lost my baby. I buried him in a cemetery. I was laying in the hospital for 3 weeks. Couldn't even think. Couldn't say anything. And then the second, when I had the Russia, that's all my bad experience. Then, when the war ended, we came back to Poland. In 1945, we came back to Poland. Because we couldn't stay already in the place where we were born and we were living. Everything was gone. So we were living in a little town called, but the Poles took it over from the Germans, called Lange Bielawa from the Germany, but the Poles, they called it Bielawa. And then I got my, Turkestan, I got my oldest son. I got pregnant again. Because my son was, the oldest was my third one. And another experience I have when I had my boy in Turkestan, it wasn't a moil to perform a bris. So it was a Bukharan Jew, the boy. We were lucky. He brought a moil from Tashkent to this little town, Turkestan, it's called. And this moil took how many children was from the people when they came in, from the war people. So it was 6 children. They made a communal place, like a little, where they even, a little shul was like a little, where the Jews davened there. And this mole came in, and all the mothers brought in their children to perform the bris. So I remember when my son was 6 weeks old, and he was by me the third one. And I was carrying him to this little shul to make the breeze. I made him wet with my tears. I was so scared. Matter of fact, it was an accident. There was a child from 3 months. They performed the breeze and the child died. Mm. Because the infection from this chalef, they just washed with a little alcohol. And it wasn't enough, the infection. Yeah, he went into his bloodstream and the baby died. The mother got a nervous breakdown, she got me shaking. And I was sad when this child was tearing the mother's face from pain, you know. It was like they was performed the breeze without any... He was 3 months old already, it was a big child from pain. When by my boy, the infection, I was lucky the infection when it came outside. Before it healed, it took me a month. I got a doctor twice because I was just lucky that he survived this breeze.
How old was he?
He was 6 weeks.
Well, he was a baby yet?
Yeah, 6 weeks old. But he didn't heal till maybe four or five weeks. He was infected, the same thing. But I was lucky. By me, the infection was outside. Mm-hmm. But this baby, in 3 months, like I said, the infection went in inside. He was gone with urinating with blood, you know, everything. Ah, so many stories, things. But, it's too painful to even to talk about it, you know. So since the event when they came back to Poland, back until I got my daughter Esther.
Where in Poland?
In Tulanki, Bielawa, like I said, where I lived. Mm. She was born, and then my husband got this brother in Canada. We left in 1950. We came to Canada. So the Poles, they took away my everything, my baggage. I came barefoot, naked. They didn't have nothing when I came in 1950 to Canada. They took everything away from me.
Did you left Poland?
Yeah, they say because I didn't make the right papers. I didn't have the right to go out from the places where they took it over from the Germans. Because I went to Canada and my husband had me coming to the Gdynia, to the station. But I didn't have the right papers. And I have to go back. I'm supposed to lose my passport because they give me a passport. It was valid for 5-6 days. On the ship Batory just came every second week. So to save my baggage, to go, so I would have to lose the passport and couldn't go out and they wouldn't give me another one maybe. So I left everything behind and we went on the boat like this, just like I said, I made a bundle. Remember the other day?
I don't remember.
No, like they wouldn't let me to take everything from the. I was standing the last one on the ship to leave, already from Gdynia, the port. So I went over to this. The ship was already signaled to leave. When I was crying, I said, "Go over to one big machad." And I said, "You let it." I'm Polish. I said, "You let me go with 2 small kids in this boat. I have not even a cushion to put them on this to sleep on the floor. Let me go and take a cushion for my children." So he opened up I got maybe 500 kilo baggage. What I got.
Kilo?
500 kilogram.
Mm-hmm.
I got a lot of things. So I opened up the box and I took a little tablecloth. And what I managed to schlep out from this big box. And so I took 2 cushions, a couple blankets, as I can. He made a bundle in with them, went up the boat on the ship Batory. He came to Canada in 1950.
You had this your possessions?
Yeah, my children, those were my possessions when I came to America, to Canada. And thanks God, my husband worked hard, and thanks God, we made a little success. Now I'm living comfortable and nice and fine. I have my nice kids and grandchildren. I got 2 in Canada. I got my daughter Tammy born in Canada. My son Arnold born in Canada.
So you have 4 children?
I have 4. 2 boys and 2 girls.
Can I take you back to Russia or would you rather not?
Yeah, she'll ask me what you want.
Okay, you talked about the first camp you had gone to.
Diktarka.
Diktarka.
Yeah.
And then you had stayed there a year and a half, and then you said you moved to another camp?
No, we didn't move. That's when the war broke out with Russia and Germany. We could live free.
Oh, then you could live free.
They freed the Polish citizens. We could go by ourselves and we went away to Turkestan. Like I told you, and there when in Turkestan, where I came with my 10-month-old baby, that's when I lost my baby.
Okay. I'm sorry, I misunderstood that part.
Yeah.
Totally, how long did you live in Russia, do you know?
Oh, in Russia we lived from 1940 till 1945, 5 years. We were in Russia.
You were in Dektala.
Diktarka.
Diktarka.
Yeah.
For a year and a half.
Yeah.
And Turkestan for Turkestan the rest of the time?
Turkestan the rest of the time, yeah.
Okay. What did your husband do in Turkestan?
He was... He did a lot of things. He was working in a drugstore. He supplied the drugs. He went with a truck to other places and he brought the drugs to this place. He was working a lot of things. We manage, we sell a little. For ourselves, what we have, I had a costume that my uncle sent me before I left in Prusani, so I sold it. I got a 16 pounds of flour to bake bread, to eat. And we survive as much as we can. I before gambled, coived,
No, don't do that. You're talking to me in Yiddish. Speak to me in English. A bit of what?
You are a little bit like a sell, buy and sell.
Oh,
thing,
okay.
You know?
I'm sorry, when you go off on another language,
yeah,
I'm lost.
Yeah, it's okay. We did a little buying, selling, you know,
merchant.
To survive, that's all. That's all that we want to just survive and have food on the table. We didn't ask for luxury.
In this Turkestan, were there Russians living there?
Sure.
It's a Russian town?
Oh, yeah. This was the Middle Ages.
How did the Russians react to the Jews? Was there any anti-Semitism?
To tell the truth, there wasn't anti-Semitism. Like the woman, their men were fighting on the front, and they saw the Polish people, going in the streets, they not on the front lines. It was a lot of jealousy, you know, but not especially openly, like they would be afraid they're going to do something to you. No, I don't think so.
When the war was first started between Poland and Germany, is that when you were allowed to go free?
Yeah. When the war broke out between Russia and Germany, they let the Polish citizens free.
Russian?
Because, yeah.
Okay.
They want them to go on the front to fight against
them. Did a lot of the Jewish men go on the front?
Oh, yeah. A lot of them went in the Polish army. They form a Polish army.
Yeah.
No, and they put a lot of them away to, a lot of them away to Iran, through Iran. They went to the Polish army and they went to Israel, a lot smuggled into Israel. A lot of the children went to Israel, like orphans. They went away to the Israel then from Russia.
I had a question and it went out of my mind. I'm sorry. I had a question in my mind. I can't remember what it was.
So maybe you remind yourself.
Did you live in a ghetto type thing in Turkestan? Did the Jews stay together?
In Turkestan.
Did they form their own community?
No, it wasn't living in a ghetto.
They just lived in amongst all the other people?
Yeah.
Did you start practicing your religion again during this time? Was there any comeback of Judaism?
No.
How did the war affect your relationship with Judaism?
To tell you the truth, I can't tell you anything. Affected me a lot. To think what the Germans did to the nicest people in the best intelligent people, whether they killed the rabbis right away. The first thing that they killed the rabbis, and they killed all the better people. You know, even the better intelligent people couldn't survive because they weren't used to a hard life. Even the Polish people, the people where they lived, like they were rich before the war. They wasn't used to hunger. They wasn't used to hard work. This the worst. These people was like flies. They die. A lot of people died in Russia from diseases. A lot from typhoid, from typhoid fever. They were like wasn't medicine.
Were there doctors?
Was doctors, but they didn't have the medicine to give them. Everything went for the soldiers.
Were there doctors in this Diktarka?
Diktarka, yeah, it was doctors.
I pronounced
it
right.
It was a lot of lady doctors.
Oh, lady doctors?
A lot of lady doctors.
Did you leave Judaism, or do you feel you became more religious because of your experience?
No, I didn't become more religious. I was like this the same. I believe... what I remember from my father, let him rest in peace. But I wasn't. I don't know. I believe in goodness more than I believe a person should have a good heart and help other ones. And I believe you shouldn't lie, you shouldn't steal, you shouldn't take anybody's. That's all what I believe. I don't believe in all this mishigas. I just say every religion is just a spirit. You have to have everything inside. If a person is good, a person wouldn't see, if you sit in hungry and I'm eating, I would, if you can't share and offer, just be selfish and eat yourself. To me, is a mensch we could share. It's like a person you could share and feel and could help. It's more valid than a Jew that goes with the payas and sit in shuffles. I have a stepmother in Buenos Aires. I have she sit and dams every day. She dams. And she wasn't good to me. She even didn't treat my father good. She was a schlechter Mensch. She was a bad person. Even she was frim, religious. You could die for her eyes. She wouldn't share nothing with you. So to me, it's what is good or good. The frim, she's frim. She has nothing inside.
You say that she's still alive in Buenos Aires now?
Yeah, she's still alive.
How old is she?
She must have been about 78.
What year were you born in, can I ask? Can I ask your birthdate? You never gave it.
When I was born? 1915.
What was the date?
The 15th of April.
Oh, tax day.
Ah?
Our tax day is April 15th here in this country.
Yeah.
Did you receive news when you were after you were in Turkestan? Did you start receiving news about the exterminations?
No.
You never heard any
nothing
of
that? Nothing. Still, we came back to Poland. It was sad as it's called, we know already.
Did you ever see one of the extermination camps after you came back?
No, I didn't see my husband, so not me.
How did you keep track of time? You had newspapers or no?
In Russia?
Yeah.
It was the Russian papers we had, but we didn't know anything about what's going on. got in Poland, but the Germans do to the Jews.
Did you keep any sort of diary?
No. My old diary is in my head.
Why do you think you survived?
My father passed away in Buenos Aires. You know, my father passed away in Buenos Aires. He lived through Russia too with the whole family. He was in Arkhangelsk.
What?
Arkhangelsk. There is in the forest, in the bushes, the wilderness in Arkhangelsk. There were they were sent them away. That's where you survived too. That was the same miracle that I was surviving. He was working very hard to feed seven kids. My father was in rest in peace. You know, uncle of my brother all to Buenos Aires in 1948. My uncle brought the whole family, 19 people, he brought to Buenos Aires. He smuggled them from Montevideo, from Uruguay. Buenos Aires didn't let it in, the Jewish people. So they smuggled them, they brought them to Montevideo, and then they smuggled them by boat to Buenos Aires. My uncle's still alive from Buenos Aires, and they took all the families.
Why do you think you survived?
Why I survived? Like other things, why I survived, God forbid, somebody's sick and I'm healthy. Just a coincidence, that's all. Why I survived, but I'm deserving to survive. It was just it happened. Any other things happen. What is the question why I think why I've survived? It's plenty of people. People survived in Auschwitz too.
Mm-hmm.
Millions went to the gas chambers.
I wasn't saying anything wrong that the fact you survived.
No, why I survived, I don't know. I don't know why I survived. Not because I'm so something special that I survived, that I did something good. No, it was just happened. It's like, I can't answer this question.
Okay.
They see so many millions have entered the gas chambers, and so many people survived in Auschwitz.
Mm-hmm.
Take a look. Some families survived 3-4 people. My husband's family, they all perished. But 3 beautiful young brothers and a sister and a mother and father. Nobody survived from my husband's family. Nobody. And my father saved all the 7 sons. And my stepmother, and I lived through. I wasn't with my father together. I was in another place.
Had your mother died?
My mother died when I was 5 days old. I didn't know my mother. My that's when my father remarried. When he got 7 boys, me the second, she's still in Buenos Aires, like I told you before. Mm-hmm.
Did you ever live in a displaced persons camp after you left Russia?
In a what?
Displaced persons camp.
What meant displaced?
If you had been in a concentration camp and had been liberated, they moved you to a displaced persons camp to give you food and get you strong enough to move.
No, no.
You just strictly went back into a town and started working.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you have any documents or letters or artifacts from the time that you were in Russia?
No, I have nothing. Everything is in my mind.
Everything's in your mind.
Yeah, I went when we came back from Russia to Poland, we went to Katowice. And from Katowice, we went to Langi Bielaw. And then my husband, with a partner, opened a store. And we sell for shoemakers, like the shoemakers, all the things what you're making shoes.
Mm-hmm.
When I was living there till I came to Canada in this little town. My daughter Esther's born in this little town.
In Langibelau.
Langibelau. Langibelau.
Langibelau.
In Polish it's called Bielawa. And this is a German, was Langibelau. In Polish, Bielawa. Bielawa, they spell it this way. So, can I write it here?
Yeah, you can read it there. Say it out loud as you spell it so that they can hear it in the tape.
Bielawa. B. E
That's nine.
Yeah. B-I-E-L-A-W-A. Bielawa, that's the spelled in Polish.
Okay. Did you find when you came back to Bielawa?
Bielawa. Yeah.
Lying below.
Lying below.
Lying that's below. Endowment. It's easier.
Yeah.
Is it okay?
Yeah, lying below.
Okay.
Yeah.
When you went back to lying below, did you find, do you recall any anti-Semitism?
There.
Yes.
Was plenty. But it was still the Germans there when I came. I live in a house with a German doctor. He gave me a room in his house. When I went to the hospital to have my daughter, Esther, so was came in a nurse in my room. She was reading a letter. And at the end of the letter, she was saying, Heil Hitler. And I got so scared and I told my husband, I'm not going to stay in this hospital, I'm afraid. But she kissed the letter and said, Heil Hitler. And I told this the doctor, there was a woman, the woman doctor. Mm-hmm. It was not a man doctor, it was a woman. And I told her that she asked me to I should show her who did it. She was a German too.
Mm-hmm.
But then they fired her from the hospital. Then. Mm-hmm. Oh, plenty. Still was plenty.
Do you remember any other experiences?
You know, my experience was in this doctor's house. My little boy was 2 years old when I came. My first, but I told you I got the priest when he was 6 years. So when he came back to Poland, in the Langibilau, we were living in this German doctor's house. So it was a kitchen to cook. And they have she had a maid. So the doctor's wife came into the kitchen and she saw my little boy's hat on the chair. So she went over and took this little hat like this, like a disease. She was
between your thumb and your index finger.
Yes, and she carried it and hung up on the door button.
The knob.
And I was so annoyed. And my husband came in and I told him this. So he went over to her. We give her because we weren't afraid then, because we knew they made them wear yellow bands, the Germans, then the Poles. They did to them what they did to the Jews.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes. When the Poles took it over this German town, they made the Germans wear bands. When they got a curfew, they're not allowed in the restaurants, they're not allowed in the nightclubs, they're not allowed to go over there, like a curfew. They have to be up from the street 10 o'clock in the night. You couldn't see a German in the street.
They had the whole house, though, and you had one room, or they had one room also?
They went on the headache. And there was a lot of other families, but they came in from the war. Took the rooms.
Each of the rooms was
the
a different
The Poles give them, and they cook in one kitchen. So then he told her, you have Hitler blood. You haven't got enough. My husband told her that.
Did you talk about your experiences after the war?
To who?
Anyone.
I'm talking between...
To neighbors.
To neighbors, between my children, all the time. All the time.
What is their reaction, the response to it?
Some of them saying it's not even comparison, not even one. It's not this what the people, how much we lived through in Russia, it's not this what the people, but they were in Auschwitz, but they were in concentration camps. They got 100 times worse. At least we were not. Nobody was standing with a gun right to kill us every second, like they were by the Germans.
Mm-hmm. Do you have nightmares?
No.
Does your past ever interfere with your life today?
I don't think so.
What are your feelings about discussing your experiences?
What is the talk now about experiences? It's over. And I hope it would never return times like this. I wish my children, my grandchildren shouldn't live through this agony from the war like we did. And what can I say?
What are your hopes and plans for the future?
Hope to be healthy, to have nachas for my kids, see my children happy. That's it. What can I ask? Thanks God we don't have to struggle to survive. But thanks God my husband make a living and I have what I want. Living comfortably, going on vacations. But else, I have to just enjoy life and be healthy. That's as much as I can.
Are you a Canadian citizen?
Oh, yeah.
What does Canada mean to you?
Canada? It's a nice country, and I live very good in Canada.
What does Israel mean to you?
Well, Israel is a Jewish country. Israel is the pride from the Jewish people. And we should be peace there, and the people in Israel should live in peace. That's all what we want. It's Jews all over the world. They need a Jewish state. They need a Jewish country. We wander plenty all over the world.
Yeah.
Now we could keep our heads high that we got a Jewish country. We could live everywhere, but we know Israel is our country.
Is your son married, your oldest son?
Oh, yeah, he's got 2 children.
How many grandchildren do you have altogether?
6.
You have 6 grandchildren right now?
Yeah.
And maybe Tammy will get married.
If Tammy will get married, I hope so. I'm expecting more.
I think this would be a good spot to end this. Okay? Is there anything else you wanted to say?
What can I say? For example, what do you want me to say?
No, I just felt that if there was something that you wanted on the tape, that I wanted to give you a chance before I turned it off. I don't know. You're beaming right now.
I don't know, to tell you the truth. I'm not such a good speaker. I want to see everybody happy. I want to see should be peace in this world. Nobody should live through wars anymore, like we do. I hope my children wouldn't experience this bad times that we have in our lives. On the second, we are fortunate enough to survive. That's true. Many, many millions didn't live to see a world, and like didn't even live to see a state of Israel. So I think we could say we're fortunate enough to come to this free country, this free continent, not to live in, even a lot of Jews in Russia now, they struggle. They don't live a life like we do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's all, what can I say? Should be peace of the world, that's all. No killings, no wars. Everybody should have what they want. What do you wish for?